Okay, thank you. Good morning. Now you wonder, here's a guy that has a German uniform on and he wants to talk about Hitler and the Hitler Youth. So before I do that, I take off the uniform because the uniform came later in my life. Okay? Anyway, I'm Hermann the German to my friends. That's easy to remember, I guess. I was born in 1934, so I'm 84 years old. A little too old for doing this stuff, but somebody has to do it and people have to learn what happened. What I'm going to tell you is what I saw, but I heard. I don't add to it, I don't take away from it. When you hear me say certain things and you don't agree with it, that's fine. That's just the way it is. So 1934, I was born in Essen. Essen is the town that made all the war supply. That's where the Krupp factories were. They made the big guns, they made the tanks, everything. Now, these are the Krupp factories. They all bombed out and burned out, as you can see. My father's business, my father had a plumbing business. There's a church over here and his business was right next to it. I lived about two blocks away. Now anybody that from World War II, when they started bombing, 75% of the bombs never hit the target. Okay? Because the bomb site, I guess, came later, and the bombs either fell too soon or fell too early. When the war broke out, obviously was 6 years old, 1941, the bombing really started. In the daytime, it was by the English, and at nighttime, it was by the Americans, and later on that changed. When they had more airplanes, some of them B-17s you see flying around or sitting here, they have a big punch, okay? So in 41, 42, a friend of my father came and says, "Hey, volunteer your son for the Hitler Youth, because I don't have a brother and I ran out of shoes." And since 41, 42, all the leather stuff went to the German army. In the US Army, we have this web belt stuff, but the German Army all had leather stuff. So I go all of that, and at age 9 years old, my father marched me to the Hitler Youth office. And hallelujah, they accepted me. And 2 weeks later, I had a complete uniform, including leather shoes. Okay, and for a little kid that's 9 years old, that's a big thing. Because the shoes we had at that time, they had wooden soles on it. And try to walk ones in a wooden sole, that doesn't work too good. And you can't run with it either. And as a young kid, you know, you like to run and like to do things. So anyway, so I'm 9 years old, I have a complete uniform. I look like this guy's over there. This is the Hitler Youth group from 10 to 14. And the older group was from 14 to 18. The older group, when you were 16, you became helpers on anti-aircraft guns and searchlights. And at 17, you could join the army, and at 18, they got you. So once you were a Hitler Youth, you more or less was, you were in trouble, basically. At 9, 10, 11, 12 years old, we were trained to march, but we had rifle training, we sang songs. Now, nobody ever said, "Hey, Hitler this, Hitler that." So I cannot say anything bad about it the few years that I was in the Hitler Youth, because I had a uniform and I was like the king of Cambodia. It's the same thing if you have children and you buy them a Wibbler uniform or a Boy Scouts, and the first time they wear, you know, everybody feels pretty good. And I felt pretty good because I was one of the few guys that ended up with the whole uniform. Now, some of the stuff that belongs to the uniform was a knife, and now I don't recommend that kids 9, 10 years old have a sharp knife, but that was part of the uniform. So you had to buy everything. You, Nothing was given to you. Okay? This knife, when it was brand new, cost three and a half German marks, which was less than a dollar at the time. And that gives you some idea today, if you buy real ones, they cost you $350. But at the time when they were made, $350. So as the bombing progressed, Hitler decided that he wanted to save the youth of the country, because most of the guys were in the war. And the bombing didn't do much good to the young kids, because they were dying left and right the same like everybody else. So he decided that all the kids should be sent to the south, to South Germany, near Bavaria, Stuttgart, where they have the farmlands. And the farm, on the farm, the fighter planes and the bomb was never came. So I was taken away when I was 7.5 years old from my parents, and my parents knew they might never see me again, and I knew I might never see them again, because they had to stay behind and in the big cities. My father had a plumbing business, and plumbing and electricians in the beginning of the war didn't have to go to war, because after every bombing attack, left the city, and they had no water, they had no lights, so they needed the electricians and they needed the plumbers real bad. But at the end, after 44, nothing worked, so they even took the plumbers in the army. And it became, actually, the old guys became like the, they call it German Wehrmacht, but you see pictures where these guys had no uniforms, nothing, they had rifles from Spain, from France, from Italy, whatever they confiscated during the war, they gave it to the old guys, gave you an armband that says German Army, and they say, go fight. and that was a funny looking army, but that's the way they did it at the end, because most of the guys that were in the army, millions had died, 500,000, 600,000, 700,000 became prisoners in Russia. Then Germany lost the 7th Army, and once after they lost the 7th Army, obviously the war was lost, and everybody knew about it too. So our house got bombed right in the beginning, and then we moved into my grandparents' house, and then from then I went to South Germany, and as things got real bad, my mother decided that if she had to die, then she might as well get me and we die together. I mean, that's, you know, the women feel different. The men feel different again. The men go and fight and the women don't, you know, they don't like that part, especially when it comes to kids. So my mother came in 1944, and got me back into this big city. And I spent then, from then on to practically till the end of the war, I spent year and a half in bunkers, and the bunkers, they were coal mines. My cities in Essen was also known for coal mines, and that was the reason Krupp had made the factories there, because there was plenty of coal and you needed the coal for the steel and all that other stuff that was necessary. So for a year and a half I basically did nothing. I played in the ruins. I had a heck of a time, no school, no nothing. And as a young kid, I guess you enjoy that. And the war was secondary, but Mom, you know, used to grab me and said, oh, we got to run to the bunkers every night at 6 o'clock. We would go to the bunker and we would come out at 5, 6 o'clock in the morning. And I can't say it was a bad time, but I can't say it was a good time. Because I tell you what I felt and what I saw, and as a young kid, you always wonder, well, how you get scared. Mom scared me. She usually pulled me, and you know, I wasn't walking slow enough, fast enough to the bunker, and blah blah blah. And as a little kid, you know things are not right, but it doesn't bother you as much as when you get older. You know, you can get killed, any moment. On the way from, in one of the train trips, was near the end of the war, my mom and I, we were in a train and I got attacked by fighter planes. So luckily they found the train found a spot between two mountains, and the two fighter planes came and attacked. And they usually attack from back to from the back to the front, or vice versa, depending, I guess, how they were flying. And luckily we got all off the train, and the first and the train had a crack on. The train in front had a quad gun because there were four machine guns mounted together, and the operator, the gunner, he sat in the middle and he could go backwards and shoot backwards over his shoulder with his gun. And then at the end of the train there was another one that had quad guns on it. In the beginning of the war they only had single machine guns, but at the end they had four machine guns mounted together. So when the first airplane came, the first gunner didn't shoot, okay? And he blasted the train to kingdom come. Mostly it was 20 millimeter ammunition. And at that time, all the trains, like over here, they weren't electrified, they were steam engines. And you should have seen the steam engine, there was like a sieve. It had holes all over the place and the steam was coming out. It was funny. You got a little kid, you know, you said to your mom, you say, hey, look at that thing. You know how funny that was. And then the second airplane, since the first gunner didn't shoot, he came a little lower and attacked the plane. See, so the lower you are, is the lower you go in an airplane, in a fighter plane, and you attack it right, so more you're going to hit. And my guess is that the pilot didn't use his head right, but he came lower, and then the first gunner opened up. Well, he blasted that airplane right out of the sky and flew maybe 100 yards behind the train, and then it took a dive and exploded. The funny part was that the train still could go. It was losing steam like crazy, but the train still got to the next train station, and then everybody had to get off. So, another time we were on a train, and I was traveling somewhere, and I had my uniform on, because I was proud of the uniform. It was brand new, and I looked nice in it, and I learned how to salute, and hit the salute, and all this stuff that you see in the movies and stuff like that. And I knew all that stuff. So, and the train station, and during the daytime, not many trains obviously were running anymore because the Germans, they lost all their fighter planes. Not that they lost them, they had no pilots and they had no gasoline. I have an uncle that was in the Air Force, German Air Force, and he said, we had plenty of airplanes, but we didn't have any gas. And Bill over there, that's over there, you know, he ran the run over Polesti, where they attacked the oil fields. Most the gasoline and oil came from for Germany. You had to talk to him, and then he got shot down over there. So it was, you know, it was a different time. Now, a little fast forward, I came to this country in 1952, green behind the ears, spoke two words in English, yes or no. And I came to Reading. And the owner spoke German, and he says, in 2 months we're leaving for Puerto Rico. If you want to go along, fine. If not, you know, you're going to need another job. And I said, I go with you, because you're the only guy that can talk to me. So I end up in Puerto Rico. I get to Puerto Rico in June of 52, and I have no clue what I'm getting into. I wrote to my parents. I said, I'm coming back, okay? Because I don't know English and I don't know Spanish, and Spanish sounds to me like a machine gun. So the broken English that I speak today, I learned in Puerto Rico. Okay, it's self-taught, and I make a lot of mistakes, but I don't try to go over them to correct them. I hope you understand what I'm saying. If not, you can ask me later. So, and lo and behold, I'm in the... When when I came to this country, I had to register for the draft. So I registered as soon as I was here in Reading. And now, obviously, I'm in Puerto Rico. And in Puerto Rico, I get a dear letter from Uncle Sam and says, we need you. The letter came by slow boat to China from Harrisburg. And it took 2 weeks to get to me. So the letter gets to me at 10 o'clock in the morning. By 11 o'clock, 1 hour later, I was supposed to be in Harrisburg for induction. So that didn't quite work too good. Well, I took this papers to my boss, and he took me to the office, and he said, no problem, but you want to enter the army. I said, well, you want me to go to Harrisburg? I said, you got to give me an airplane ticket. If you want me to enter in Puerto Rico, I enter in Puerto Rico. So it took 9 months to get me in the army. When I entered the army in Puerto Rico, now, in the eyes of the army, I was a Puerto Rican, and I looked like one, right? And I wasn't a citizen at the time. I was in this country 5 years, but because being in the army, they said, you don't need citizenship. You got a pass like everybody else. You look like everybody else. It's a uniform. When you get back from your station, then you become a citizen. So I coined the phrase German Rican. German, Puerto Rican, so I was the only German Rican that the army ever had. Now, I had a good time in the army, because as a young kid, I learned how to march, I learned how to shoot, I learned how to salute, all this stuff that you do in basic training. So I had a good time in the army. I used to tell everybody, I said, how the heck did you win the Second World War? You can't shoot straight, you can't march straight, you can't do anything. So I had a good time. Now, while I was in Germany, they sent me right back to Germany as an interpreter in an office. Now, I wasn't a citizen, but I was typing top secret information. You figured that one out, right? And the lieutenant came to me one day. He said, hey, Pfisterer, come here. He said, you know what you're typing? I said, no, sir. He said, you know what that is? I said, no, sir. He said, hey, you're a good soldier. So I had a typewriter that was 20 inches long and a paper to put in. And I typed this secret stuff. And the lieutenant checked it over, and he signed it, gave it to the captain. Captain put it in a big envelope with 4 stamps on each corner, top secret, top secret, top secret. And they say, well, since you're not a citizen, you know, we can't give you top secret information. He says, the best he can do is confidential. It's confidential, secret, and then comes top secret. But he says, well, we checked you out, you must be pretty good. He said, you survived the war, so you must be pretty good. And you keep typing that stuff, well, don't tell anybody. But anyway, I saw Hitler coming back to World War II. I saw Hitler 3 times. Every time the Krupp factories had a big thing going, they made the 1,000th gun, or they made the 10,000th tank, or what, Hitler would come and the guy always came in an open car, okay, and the guy on the passenger side, they had a little stool made so he could stand up, so then he was standing up. He was completely exposed. He was exposed actually from the belt line up, because he stood on this little thing and the guy wasn't that tall to begin with. And when you hear some of the history, you know, some people tried to knock him off here and there, but he had a second sense for some reason. Sometimes he told the driver after a while, he said, hey, make a left turn or make a right turn. And if he would have gone straight ahead, they probably would have knocked him off. But like I said, when you read some of that history, the way, you know, he lived and he was lucky. Everybody else got shot and bombed, but this guy, he never got into trouble except in the Wolf's Lair at the end, when they tried to kill him, and they couldn't kill him there because they made a mistake. Okay, so anyway, the guy lived till the end, but he never did any harm to me, obviously. and the things that came out of the Second World War. I asked my father many times, I said, you tell me you knew nothing about the Jewish parliament and all that stuff. And my father said no, and I asked him many times. But I had an uncle, he died about 2 years ago. He told me, he says, that was all propaganda, nothing was true. And my uncle was a high-pressure vessel engineer, submarines. He came here in 1933, married a girl here, went on honeymoon in 1938. He was trained by Krupp. Krupp knew he was there, so they kept him in Germany. After the war, he wanted to come here with me, and they said, oh, no, you cannot come here because you started the Nazi party at the Reading Liederkranz in 1933. So instead of coming here, he went to Canada. At the height of the Cold War, when we needed, you know, all the top engineers in the world for high-pressure vessels, submarines, atomic submarines, a friend of his that worked with him in Cleveland in 1933 remembered the guy and said, hey, that guy is working in Canada, but he cannot come here because he started the Nazi party in Reading, Pennsylvania. So they went to the government in Washington and they said, hey, we need this guy. You know what the government said? What Nazi party? We never heard about the Nazi party. See, that's the way it works. You know, if they need you, it doesn't matter who you are or where you come from. And within 2 weeks, he was here. And because he had a lot of his formulas in the head, because this one guy remembered, he says, man, he says, we need this guy. He says, forget about the Nazi party. So anyway, that's a side thing that happened. This uniform here is a winter uniform. The difference between my outfit, the DJs, Deutsches Jungvolk from 10 to 14, to the 14 to 18, the Hitler used an armband that was with a swastika on it. We younger guys, 10 to 14, we used this uniform. We were the only uniform that basically did not wear swastika. And a lot of people don't know that. Every uniform group in Germany in the Second World War had some kind of a swastika or some kind of an eagle. He had an eagle, but instead of a swastika, it had a hammer and a circle. I have some. I have some of my Hitler memorabilia, the Hitler Youth memorabilia on a stand over there. If anybody later on wants to look at it or wants to ask me questions, welcome to it. I tell you what I know, but I don't know, I can't tell you. But anyway, this is a winter uniform, and this is a flag helper, like I told you, and I have the badge over there, so you see what it looks like. And he has a sports award like I have. That was the only award that basically you could get in Hitler Youth. You had to run run and throw a ball and jump, what, 3 feet high or certain things, and then they gave you the sports award. And like I said, the badge. Then the Hitler Youth flag always has a white stripe in it. You see a lot of Hitler flags, they're all red. Just red with a swastika, black background. The Hitler used flags in the armband always have this white stripe to it. Instead of using the Hitler flag, we use this black banner with a rune on it. The SS used two runes, but we use just one rune. If you know what I talk about SS, they usually had two of them things on the uniform. I played a little drum, a snare drum, for a very short time. And you can see a picture of me in full uniform on my stand. But I'm only like about this size. Okay. So, while I was in the Hitler Youth, I had a lot of fun. I saw Hitler and I saw him pretty good because my father, the first time took me in that little, I didn't see anything because the sidewalks were full of people. The second time he got smart, he took a stepladder along. Okay, and he put the stepladder on and I sat on top of it. So I looked over everybody. And when Hitler came by, he was as close as you in a third row over there. And I'm almost sure he waved to me because I stuck out. I stuck out because I was the only guy sitting on a ladder and waving at the guy. So I'm almost sure he saw me and he waved back at me, at least, you know, the way I looked at it, the way I saw it. So, when Hitler came into town, you probably seen pictures that out of every window was a Nazi flag, and some flags went from the third or fourth floor all the way down to the first floor. Some of these things were tremendous. I mean, they had to be 30, 40 feet long or even longer. But the town was covered with flags, and he came with a couple of other Mercedes, well, they all were Mercedes Benz. And he had a bunch of generals with him and the SS. The SS always was dressed in black. Later on, the SS became part of the army or the SS army or SS police. Then they had regular uniforms, but in the beginning, everything was black. And all the guys that always came to think they always were dressed in black, so everybody knew they were SS. And in the beginning, that was they were his special guard, you know, that protected him, and wherever he went, the SS followed. Not everybody in the SS was a bad guy. Not everybody in any army is a bad guy. They're always exceptions. Okay, there are always some guys, they think they're better than anybody else, and they got to be tougher than anybody else. And one thing I heard about 2 weeks ago, which was on the History Channel, that the Hitler Youth had a Hitler Youth division once he was, like I told you, 17 or 18. And since they needed everybody, so in 44 they made a Hitler Youth army. It was a division, Hitler Youth division. If you were in it, you had a stripe on your arm and it said Hitler Youth Division. And these guys were, some of them guys were tough. They thought they got indoctrinated, the older ones, and they got indoctrinated in such a way that they thought they would save Germany. But you're not going to save Germany when you're 17, 18 years old. You get your butt shot off, that's really what's going to happen. Some other incident happened to me when right after the war, I got arrested by the French. The southern part of Germany became the French zone. And I had a red pin over here, and one of the officers grabbed me, and I had no clue what the heck was going on, and they couldn't speak too good German. So, until they got an officer that spoke German, it took 5-6 hours. I got arrested in the morning about 9, and they didn't let me go till about 9 at night. And when they took me, when they arrested me first, was in this little town called Speichingen, which is in the southern part of Germany. And the sidewalks were white sand. And two guys marched me to this military office, one on one side, one on the other side. I'm in the middle. And every time they made 5 or 6 steps, they would look at me. And I said, what the heck they looking at me? I had no clue what they were looking at me. And finally, I figured out it was the red pin. So I took the red pin, when they were looking, I took it out, and I threw it on the floor, but I remembered where I put it. Well, when he gets his military office, you know, these guys, they look kind of silly, because one of the other guys said, hey, where's this? They're telling me he has a red pin, but... And I'm surmised that, you know, because I couldn't hear French, but when you see what they were looking at and the way we were talking, so they had to do with the red thing. So they put me in a corner, and I stood for 4 hours watching the corner. No sitting down, no food, no nothing. So the interpreter comes and he asks me all kinds of questions. He says, what the heck happened? You know, why you have a red pin? I said, my mother is a seamstress. My mother was a master seamstress. I said, she has red ones, green ones, blue ones. And I said, we use them in school to hang it, you know, a little paper on the kids' back. That's why it wasn't. You know, there's always a couple of them in the school, you know, you do pranks and tricks on them. Okay, so they sent a policeman to the school. In the next town where I was, and they asked the teacher. They said, "Are you guys doing this? Blah blah blah." The teacher confirmed it. They got to my mother. They said, "You're a seamstress." She said, "Yeah, how many pins you want?" "You had a whole box of." So finally they let me go. But then my mother said, she says, "Now what's the problem?" And she says, "Oh," he said, "there's a Hitler youth group where I come from that blows up British and American tanks and trucks at night." It was one of them, you know, guys that they didn't want to get loose of the war. You know, they thought they were special. And so at night they went around and blew up everybody. And their identification was this red pin. Well, I didn't know that. Okay, how did I know that? I'm 400 or 500 miles away from there. The good part is that the French never asked if I was in the Hitler Youth. They always ask about the red pin. They never said, "Is this guy in the Hitler Youth?" If they would have asked, "Yes, he was in the Hitler Youth," I'd probably still be locked up. You know, because I would have had a hard time explaining why I had this red pin. But what I told them was the truth, and they checked it out. So, looks like my time is up.